Let us pray. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for how you always call us and give us things in our life, things we don't quite understand, how perhaps we've laid out plans and we have this idea of how we think. It's presented to us from the law, but God, you gave us grace. And you gave us mercy. And the law that you gave us is not a way of condemnation. It's not a way of judgment. But it is a way that we can look and see the mighty workings of your grace. God, I want to pray for CJ, particularly, and Mariah. They will understand the great responsibility that they have in order to be parents. And God, for all the other parents that's in this place, we pray for them as well. They'll stand to the test because the world is an ever-changing place. And things we thought we knew, we don't know. We just learn to live and give you glory and honor. Jesus' name we do pray. Today I want to look at, and perhaps over the next couple of weeks, is roadblocks in life. Today we want to look at the fact that your past could be a roadblock. It is my contention that many times that when we are asking for volunteers, or we're asking for teachers, and we're asking for deacons, trustees, and even going into life at various places and times, is that we stop and look at and relive our past, and we think that because of my past, I'm not qualified, I'm not capable, I'm not good enough in order to do this, that God will, to stand in front of people. And I believe this more than anything, is that more people would stand in front of people if they were not reliving their past. And so many times in your life, is your past can be a roadblock. Now here's one of the things that I believe that your past can be a roadblock on. It could be the fact is that I don't really know that much about the Bible. Do you realize the Hebrew word for teach and learn are the same word? So when I have to teach, I learn more. And so if you're given the opportunity to come alongside somebody and be a teacher or mentor or whatever, you'll learn more. And this is what you have to understand in life. I mean, can you imagine the number of years that I've probably been a preacher, 25 years or so or more or whatever, and I guarantee you I probably, in the way of percentage-wise, probably don't know 10 or 15% of what the Bible actually really says. And much of what I do know, I don't really understand. But I feel like God has called me to be a mentor, to be a person who presents and can offer life change. And I don't know about what you think about your past, but I know my past. And if I will allow my past to qualify me, I would just like not even sit in the church. I'd sit outside the church on the porch. And so my past does not qualify me to be here, but God's grace does. Because there was a time in my life I came to a crossroad and I had to make a choice or a decision of whether I want to live by God's ways or I want to live by the ways the world put us into or push us into or lure us into and tempt us to live that way. That's a situation that has occurred throughout the time. And in the passage of scripture that I want to use today to kind of highlight what it is I'm trying to talk about is one Old Testament passage and one New Testament passage. The Old Testament passage is Jeremiah 6 and 16. And it says this, and during this time, God tells Jeremiah, go tell the people this. He said, this is what the Lord says, stop at the crossroads and look around. Ask for the old godly way, the old way. Hey, y'all, I know we're living in a new day, in a new time, and everybody's doing new stuff and whatever. But the Bible right there is saying, look at the old godly way in life. He said, and walk in it. That means some of the stuff that we used to do ain't that bad. You know? He said, travel is past, and you will find rest for your soul. But you, as I preach this Sunday after Sunday, but you replied, no, that's not the road we want. I'm giving it to you Sunday after Sunday. You're learning it time and time again. As parents, you're giving it to your kids. And they're looking you right back in your face and saying, that ain't the road I want. Not at all. So that's the way Jeremiah had. They suffered as a result of it. Then we come to the New Testament. And Jesus is having a similar conversation with his disciples. And he is explaining to them, how is it that you would enter the kingdom of God? He says this in Matthew chapter 7, verses 13, to start out with. He said, for you can enter God's kingdom only through the narrow gate. Implication, the same. But the highway to hell is broad, and its gate is wide, for many choose that way. Now listen at what he is saying. Look at your friends. Look at other members in your family and all. They're on that wide road. They're headed to, you know, through a wide gate. They're on their way to hell. But if you are interested in going into the kingdom of God, it's a very narrow gate. You have a crossroads. You make a choice. Do I want the narrow gate or do I want the wide gate as well? One of the things that I've come to realize in life is that when there are new roads, there are new opportunities. New roads present new opportunities in life. And a lot of times when you're going through life and you're doing various things in life, it's almost like a no-brainer. You know, no-brainer meaning, you know, no real thought. Doesn't matter which way you do it, one way or the other. For example, if you're riding down the road and you're hungry and there's a Taco Bell on one side, Chick-fil-A on the other side, it don't really matter. You know, that's like a no-brainer. It just depends on what you like. Go anywhere you want as well. And you're sitting at a stop sign, four-way stop sign. You have the option to go left, right, straight as well. Well, it doesn't really matter. No-brainer situation, because of this fact is that if I choose the wrong way, all I got to do is a U-turn or another turn someplace else and go back and correct that and get it right. That's a pretty much no-brainer situation. But here's another one. It's like if you were thinking, and you were thinking like, do I tithe or do I rob a bank? Well, that's really a no-brainer situation as well now. But I'm just probably sure that what you would choose would be, I'm going to tithe. Okay, that's your choice. You just picked it. All right. Now, but listen at this. Let me just say this. Here's a follow-up question to that may be a no-brainer. If I rob the bank, do I tithe 10%? The answer to that question is yes, you do. All right. The other answer is, and I know this one is right there on your heart. What is the lottery number for this week? Is it $1.4 billion? If you win, you tie. Okay. No brainer. No brainer right there. You got to remember that. See, now, most of the decisions that you make in life, they're really not as easy as the ones that we've talked about so far. Many of the decisions that you make in life will have personal or relational consequences in your life, and they could be devastating. And so you must make the right decision at that crossroad as well. And you must not allow your past, meaning your past thinking, or your past circumstances or situations as well, to interfere with you making the decision to live the godly way or the world's way. Because that's the crossroads that I'm talking about today. Now, money. Let's talk about money. In other words, how are you going to manage your money in your life? What are you going to do with your money? Things like that. Are you going to manage your money according to God's standards? Or are you going to manage your money the way the world tells you to? Go out, grab possessions and pleasure with your money. Take the bus trip, right? I know. You're going to take your tithes and take the bus trip. That's not really a no-brainer. But here we go again. What about relationships? When it comes to relationships and how I treat one person or another, how am I going to do it? Am I going to treat people based on God's standards? Am I going to treat people based on the world standards? Am I going to follow the standards that are given to me by Dr. Phil, Dr. Laura, and Dr. Oprah? I'm not sure. You got a choice that you got to make as well. How about your sexuality? When it comes to your sexuality, what are you going to do when you hit the crossroads? How are you going to express your sexuality? Are you going to do it the way God has designed it to be expressed? Are you going to do it the way you see it implied on advertisements and billboards and in the media and on television and other things like that? And then here's another thought that I come to realize. When you think about it, following the world's way is a lot easier than following God's way. That's why the world's way is narrow, is wide. God's way is narrow as well, but it's easier to follow the world's way, because the world's way, listen at this, it is alluring, it is seductive, and it's tempting as well. We see far more of that than we do any other thing as well in life. But I know stories, and as I look throughout this congregation, I see people who have stories and scars in their life because they chose to make the wrong decision before they knew Christ. And some of them made the wrong decision after they knew Christ. The fact that we come to know Christ does not make us necessarily make better decisions as well in our life. We come to know Christ, accept Christ as our Savior, as young people in our life, and we still make bad choices and bad decisions in our life because the world way is alluring, it's seductive, and it's tempting as well in their life. I got a question for you. Right now, if you had to make a decision in your life today, how would you like for your life to be characterized if you were dead and gone? You don't want to talk about that, but it's going to happen to you. If you were dead and gone, would you want people to talk about you as having a life characterized by living God's way or the world's way? Now, I know the way funerals are done nowadays is like you live the world way all your life. And then when it's time to bury you, they tell all kind of lies about you. They'll put you in heaven right there. They'll think they're putting you in heaven, but you ain't in heaven. Listen, you got to understand that he'll give you the shirt off his back. Yeah, right. And so here we are at a message today. And I want to try to give you an example of a person biblically who had an awful past, but God took his awful past because he went through what is called a genuine conversion to an amazing transformation, hence the video. He went through a transformation, okay? Our past can be a roadblock, an eventful past. A person in scripture who had an eventful past. Now you can pick a lot of people because most of the people in the scriptures had eventful pasts that God used them as well. All right, but the person we want to talk about today is a man by the name of Saul. Anybody know Saul? You know him as Paul, right? And so in my presentation, I may say Saul, I may say Paul. It's the same thing, okay? He's the same man. But in Acts 7:58, we find this verse in a man who had an eventful past. He was there one day, and he said, they dragged him out, which is Stephen. They dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. His accusers took their coats off and they laid them at the feet of a young man named Paul. Isn't that when we typically make our mistakes when we're young? Paul is there. He's a young man. He's all sidetracked. But look at the 8th chapter, verse number 1. Saul was one of the witnesses, and he agreed completely with the killing of Stephen. A great wave of persecution began that way, sweeping over the church in Jerusalem, and all the believers except the apostles were scattered through the region of Judea and Samaria. Verse number 3 says this, but Saul, he then, you know, being excited like a young man, he began going everywhere to destroy the church. He went from house to house, dragging out both men and women and throw them in prison. An eventful past. In chapter 9, verse number 1, it says this. Meanwhile, Saul was uttering threats with every breath and was eager to kill the Lord's followers. So he went to the high priest. In other words, he had this idea, I'll do this, but I get permission to do it as well. It's what he was saying. That's his life. It's an uneventful path, which we've all had. In the 26th chapter, verse number 10 says this, indeed, I did that in Jerusalem, authorized by the leading priests. I caused many believers there to be sent to prison. I cast my vote against them when they were condemned to death, and many times I had them punished in the synagogue. I went to their churches while they were having church, and I punished them. I punished them to curse Jesus. I was so violently opposed to them that I even chased them down in foreign cities. That is the context of the Apostle Paul, or Saul, as we would know him. Now, what is Paul in this particular context? Paul is a Jesus hater. He is an anti-Jesus leader as well. He is head or leader of the Jesus anti-movement as well. And the other guy we talked about was Stephen. Stephen was a faithful disciple and follower of Christ at the time. Stephen was that person who would not shut up about Jesus Christ. Stephen was that kind of person who you would say, how you doing? He would say, blessed and highly favored. Who you blessed by the best as well in his life. Stephen would not shut up about Jesus. But you know what I love about this portion of scripture? It's not because persecution has happened in it. I love it because in the midst of the persecution, I love how God takes a negative situation and makes it a positive one as well. In other words, when you know Romans 8:28 says all things work together for good, let me show you how this works. It says this, God takes this situation of persecution, and as it hit, he runs all the believers away. But what are they carrying with them? They're carrying their faith. They're carrying the word of God. They're carrying the good news of Jesus Christ with them as well. Now listen. It doesn't take a lot of intelligence to realize this, that at this particular time, the Apostle Paul, Saul, was a despicable human being as well. He had innocent blood on his hand. He was what we might entitle today and age as being a terrorist, because that's what he really was. He was a murderer, and he would murder people for the only crime of the fact that they believed in Jesus Christ and believed who Jesus Christ said he was, meaning he was the Messiah as well. Now, in the day and age that we live, there are a lot of anti-Jesus people. They don't have the authority that the Apostle Paul has in this day and age. But you know what they got? They got a microphone. They got a website. They got a TV show or whatever. And they do the exact same thing. And listen, Paul's goal was to say, stop going God's way originally and go the world's way. That is the goal of any anti-Jesus person today, is go the way of the world. Now, when we look at Paul's past, we're not looking at a minor character flaw. We're looking at something major. This is big stuff. But thank God, Paul didn't stay rooted in his past. Saul didn't stay rooted in his path, because of the second thing that I want to talk about is he had a genuine conversion in his life as well. A genuine conversion. We look at Acts chapter 26 and verses 12 through 18. It says this. One day I was on such a mission, meaning to kill Christians, to Damascus. I was armed with the authority of the commission of the leading priests. About noon, Your Majesty, he's given a testimony. Your Majesty, I was on that road. A light from heaven, brighter than the sun, shone down on me and my companions. Like whoever was with him. We all fell down. And I heard a voice saying to me in Aramaic, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Listen at the rest of this verse. It is useful. Useless. For you to fight against my will. Let me say that one more time. I don't know who I'm talking to. It is useless for you to fight against the will of God. He was saying, as long as you fight against me, you cannot win as well in his life. And we must understand that as well. Now, look at the next verse. He says, who are you, Lord? The Lord replied, I am Jesus, the one that you are persecuting. Now get to your feet, for I have appeared to you to appoint you as my servant and witness. Tell the people you've seen me, and tell them what I will show you in the future. I will rescue you from both your own people and the Jews and the Gentiles. Yes, I am sending you to the Gentiles. Gentiles, they aren't supposed to have the gospel. Jesus said, I'm sending you to the Gentiles to open their eyes so that they may not turn darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God. Then they will receive forgiveness for their sin and to be given a place among God's people who were set apart by their faith in me. Verse number 26 of the ninth chapter says this: for when Paul arrived in Jerusalem, he tried to meet with the believers, but they were afraid of him. They did not believe he was truly become a believer. That same thing is going to happen to you as well. When you change your life, you're going to meet with resistance from people right around you. They're not going to believe that you have changed in your life. And I know what you're saying, and I know you're thinking that as I'm talking about your past being eventful as well, you're probably saying, you don't know my story. You don't know what I've done in my life. You don't know my past. But Paul is retelling his story. And so what I'm telling you, and I want to encourage you, that for the sake and the glory of God, is retell your story. Yes. Not for the fact that you gloried in your sin, but the grace of God was big enough to bring you past your sin. That's why you tell it. It's because no test, no testimony in life. And you got to make people understand that no matter. And this is like one of my favorite verses I learned. And this is one of the verses that helped get me back on track in life, to make me understand that I could do what it is God called me to do. And it is Romans 5:20. And in the end of the verse, B portion of it says this: but where sin abound, grace does much more abound. Yeah. And you know what? Know how we would say that? You cannot outsin the grace of God. Ernie always say you can't outgive God, but you can't outsin the grace of God as well in your life. You got to understand that you can move past your sin as well in your life. Listen, when you know how do you move past it? It's when you have gone through a genuine conversion in your life. You got to understand that, because when you've gone through a genuine conversion, you will come to what is known as an amazing transformation. Okay? An amazing transformation. When God puts his spirit in you, you will be what is called transformed. Look at this amazing transformation of the Apostle Paul in Acts chapter 9, verse 20 and 21. And immediately he began to preach. Y'all hear me? Paul got the call from Jesus Christ, and it said immediately he answered the call. He began to preach to Jesus in the synagogue, the same synagogues he had gone in and destroyed people in there. And you know what he was preaching them, saying, indeed he is the Son of God. He was saying, I was running around in life trying to tell you he is not the Son of God, but now I'm telling you he is indeed. And he said, all who heard him was amazed. And they were saying this, he's preaching, and they're saying, isn't this the man that caused such devastation among Jesus' followers in Jerusalem? They asked. And didn't he come here to arrest them and take them in chains to the leading of priests? They were like, can we believe what he is telling us in life? Yeah, they could believe him. You know why? Because the one word, it was a transformation. Listen, when I think of the word transformation, I first off think of the word of a butterfly. Where did a butterfly come from? What was his beginning in life? He came from an ugly caterpillar. However, many of us would never put our hands on a caterpillar. You hold your hand out and let a butterfly light on. I love this time of year because it's a fall time of flowers, to where lantanas and cassanquas and all these trees are blooming, and you see these gorgeous butterflies in there. Look at the butterfly. It looks nothing like the caterpillar. Is that right? And now you're wondering about the video, the transformation. Did you realize that the cars and trucks, once they were transformed, they didn't look like what they looked like before? Oh, don't miss the point here. It had nothing to do with that. It had nothing at all to do with it. But it was to show you an example that when you've been transformed by God, you don't look like anything that you look like before in your life. You don't have the same goal. You don't have the same mission. In the Greek, it's called metamorphosis as well in your life. And as I was watching that video, and I watched it over and over and over again, trying to see how it applies, then I thought about the day and age that we live in. And I heard this thought. It says, right off the bat, is we're in the middle of an ongoing war. Are we not? Yes, we are in the world that we live in. It also said you've never faced anything like this. I don't care if how much we quote the verse, there's nothing new under the sun. This seems like a new hard day. Stuff that we see happening looks like it never happened before. We've never faced anything like this. And then in the video it says, be on guard because it's going down. Listen. You better be on your guard because it's happening. It's going down. And then it says this. Keep your eyes open and life will show you everything that you need to know. Listen at me. Are you looking? Are you cognizant of what's going on in the world? God is trying to show you. This world is a horrible place. And the way life is being lived out is horrible as well. And then it says this. We can find it alone or we can find it together. And then it says together. That's how we do it. We need to be together. It closed by saying this, let's get to it. Church, let's get to it as well. Saul's life was an immediate transformation. He goes from being a destroyer to a follower of Jesus Christ. He goes from being the anti-leader of Jesus movement to a missionary for Jesus Christ. He goes from being a terrorist to a tender person in his life. It is an amazing transformation in his life. That is a quick snapshot of the life of the Apostle Paul. And if you want to read more about him, there's 16 books in the New Testament that the Apostle Paul made. And I know you think to yourself, well, you can't even relate to what's going on in my life. But I can relate. I can relate by the life that the Apostle Paul has lived. And I know this as well. We all have an eventful past. We all do. There's nobody sitting here does not have an eventful past. There's not one of us in here today that pretty much haven't gone through a genuine conversion in our life or an amazing transformation as well in our life. And the Apostle Paul, as he goes through it in life, he gets to a point to where he says this, and I always thought was like, oh my God, how can you do this and get to this point in your life? If he says these words, follow me as an example as I follow Christ. I wonder, can you go to your friends and your coworkers, the students that you go to school with and people that are around you in your family and say, follow me as I follow Christ? Because they know you better than the people you go to church with. They see you coming and going as well. That's an amazing transformation. When you in your mind can look at other people and say, follow me as I follow Christ as well in my life. Now, what does it mean? Let me just say this to the person who might be in this place today. Perhaps you're not even a basic follower of Jesus Christ. Let me just say this to you today. I'm thrilled that you're here. And I'm glad that you chose Pine Grove to come to the day, be a part of the service this weekend as well. And I want you to know this. This is my message to you. God wants to take your eventful past. He wants you to go through a genuine conversion and experience a relationship with you. Experience the amazing transformation that he can give you by putting his Holy Spirit in your life. You don't even understand the people in your life who are around you as parents and relatives who are praying for you. Actual people who want to see you transformed in your life. And listen, let me tell you what I understand about transformation. The greatest effect that we can have on people in transformation of their life is when they are kids. You know, when people get old, it's hard to get them to change. It's hard to get us to see another way. I always tell this story, is that of the 100% of the people that the gospel is presented to, only 80% of them, 80% of them will come to know Christ before they are teenage years. Of the 20% that did not come, only 20% of them will ever become Christ followers in life. You got to get them while they're young and transformable in their life.
And so we are following the life of the Apostle Paul and what he said. But I want you to see what he does late in his life when he decides to write a young man that he is mentoring to, which is first, it is Timothy. And in 1 Timothy, the 15th verse, Paul says this because, and I want you to know how, you're looking at your past, perhaps. Paul writes this to Timothy. Christ Jesus came into this world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst of them all. Paul is saying, let the line start right here behind me. And you get somewhere there in this line as well. He said, but God had mercy on me so that Christ Jesus could use me as a prime example of his great patience with even the worst sinners. Paul said in one other version is this. He said that he was public sinner number one. He said, when people see me, other people will realize that they too have a chance to believe in him and receive eternal life as well. Paul is saying, I'm the worst. So I'm saying this to you today. If the Apostle Paul is worth, then you need to line up. And you wonder, like, how is God going to forgive me for my sin? Well, it's been since Old Testament back. In Psalm 103:12, it says this. God forgives us. In Psalm 103, verse number 12, for he said that he removed our sins as far as the east is from the west. You say, how far is that? It's an immeasurable, infinite distance as well between two things. That's how far God remembers your sin. But it gives us more of an explanation in Isaiah 43:25. Because God says to these people, he said, I alone will blot out your sins. And for my own sake, I will not think of them again. One reason I love the Bible and I love the Bible text is that it's not full of a group of goody-goody two-shoe people. All of them are shown with their spots. Joseph, Moses, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and all. Paul. Every one of them are shown in their sin. And so what we must understand is that that puts us in a place that we can be have sin in our life. And then all we have to do is go to God in 1 John 1:9 and say this, confess our sins to him. And he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all wickedness. You don't ever have to go back to God and say, God, would you forgive me for this again? Because he'll say, again? What are you talking about as well? Because you see, it's out of sight. And then another one of our favorite verses, 2 Corinthians 5:17. For it says this. This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone and a new life has begun as well. Listen, here's a couple of few quotes from about the past. One says this, learn from the past, prepare for the future, live in the present. That's our opportunity. Another one says this, yesterday is history, tomorrow is a mystery, today is a gift. That's why we call it the present as well. What is gone is gone. What is past is past. Nothing in this world can change that without the exception of the future. And then a man says this, the past is a ghost. The future is a dream. All we have is now. You know who said that? Bill Cosby. Now listen at me. You know that he has to look at his life as the past being a ghost, the future being a dream. All he has is right now. Many of us can do that very same thing in our life. You're here today and you've come to a crossroad in your life and you have to make a choice. Do I live God's way or do I live the way of the world? Listen, God forgives you, gives you another opportunity as well. Stand up with me if you will as we finish.